With this and one of the questions actually leading into the next presentation, we have next presentation by Dr. Chaudhary from COAP, it's College of Engineering Pune. And I would like to briefly introduce him here. Dr. Chaudhary is presently a professor of electrical engineering and dean of quality assurance at COAP, and also a member of the board of governors. He received his PhD from IIT Bombay in 2001, and he has undertaken quite a few roles at COAP. He has been the head of the Department of Electrical Engineering, dean academic, and he presently has about 6 research projects with a total funding of about 6.15 crores. He has 8 patents which have already been filed, and more than 75 papers in journals and conferences. With that, let's welcome Dr. Chaudhary for the presentation.
Thank you, Professor Bairat, and very good afternoon to all of you. At College of Engineering Pune, we have done some little work of laboratory innovation and development, and we had several we have several visitors from different parts of the country. 4 IIT directors visited us, which include Professor Shegaonkar, Professor Dhande, Professor Natarajan, and Professor Sukhatme. And they suggested us to take these efforts to the wider platform. And Professor S. V. Kulkarni even visited us. He had seen our laboratories, he had seen our development and the impact of that development, and he suggested to give a talk on the laboratory development which took place at Electrical Engineering Department at my department. And I am here to narrate you this laboratory development, different academic product which we develop in general, and set of related to electromagnetics in particular. We have in last 7-8 years we have developed these innovative laboratory setups which are attracting attention of the electrical faculty and students, which include a laboratory setup for first year lab, a all-in-one electrical machines lab, a generic transformer model, a few denominators, then few models which created interest regarding the electromagnetic field. Professor Pramanik is with, we are fortunate to have him with us from last 5-6 years. I must thank him on the behalf of entire institute, because I had only visited him once along with my colleague who is sitting there in his at Aurangabad. He was staying at Aurangabad, and we spent only 15 minutes, and on our request he migrated from Aurangabad, and at 70 I think he was 76 then. And he migrated, shifted to College of Engineering Pune. Sir, it was a great favor to us. And he took interest in developing certain models. Then we have a very unique model for power electronics and renewable laboratories, and certain models for other laboratories, and we are in the process of developing newer and newer things. Let me take very quick view on these models. This is a lab on wheel for creating interest towards the electrical engineering. The first year electrical engineering is a lab common for all courses, and there is a perception among the students that electrical engineering is a dying field. I mean, it is very interesting that the world is becoming more and more electrical decade by decade, and students in our society are thinking that electrical is a dying field. So happened, as professor also shared, that it's every theory, every development has electromagnetic field at the base, and we had a very five-star university throwing off or dumping off this subject 2 decades back. Pune University, a five-star university, has dumped this subject back from the electrical engineering curricula, I think, two decade back, and there are discussion whether we need network or not in the electrical curricula, right? So this is the sorry state of affairs. And as he also suggested, he also pointed out the labs are archives. Indeed, the COEP laboratories were created as museums, museums of electrical engineering. Electrical department, which got established in 1901, you can imagine, the laboratories were 100 years old, 75 years old. They were enjoying their 75s and 80s and centenaries. Scene were not different even in IITs. I remember the days when we were research, I was a research scholar, and there were machines, I mean, 4 or 5 decades back. It was the last decade, till last decade, 50 years, the same laboratory served. In state colleges, the scene was more terrific. It's still people are working on the same labs. People have same Schrage and commutator motors, and they are still in syllabi, and still the experimentation is on. And that's we realize that perhaps is the reason why students are not encouraged to step in the conventional laboratories, in the conventional field, and why they are going away and away from electrical engineering. We decided to make to make an attempt to try to change this. So we have provided them a very versatile platform. We call it a lab on wheel. This is a trolley which we borrowed the concept of electronic breadboard, and we had an electrical breadboard here where components are done, and there are certain meters provided, and we made several pilot plants. And this single setup, which is a trolley on a wheel, is capable of performing several experiments. Teacher changes the experiments year by year, and 750 students across the institute take this laboratory. And we are watching the performance of the students, and the results are quite fruitful. I mean, there is a definite 10-15% students who take interest. They go beyond what is given in the labs. They try to experimentally validate additional experiments given, which is not a part of curricula, which is not a part of compulsory curricula. It also provides a teacher to innovate and set up new experiment. I must thank my another colleague, who is Srinivas Baka, who is also sitting somewhere in the audience, who has used this platform and designed, with the guidance of Professor Pramani, newer experiments, which I will show shortly to you. So this is a big larger view. Just to teach a temperature coefficient, we have such a pilot heat bath. So we have an unknown coil, and there is a very low cost on off temperature controller. Student heat up the water and measure the temperature versus resistance curve, and experimentally and arrive at a alpha. That from this experiment our lab starts. It takes hardly 5-10 minutes for a student to configure a given network. The sources are variable. Teacher can literally give 20 different network problems to 20 different students, because there are so many variables. Sources are variable, components are variable. So a teacher at heart can really give a different experiment to each student, even though the class size is 75 or 80. And we have dozens of such trolleys, so we have only 2 students perform experiment. Right at the first year, the student get feel of doing the experimentation. This is another development. which has attracted attention of even elite institutes. We looked at what are the problems with the conventional machines lab. I mean, can in throughout a country, go everywhere, machines lab have same shape, because normally the teacher teaches the way in which he was taught. So normally when any young teacher is given an opportunity to develop a new lab, he goes back in memory and thinks, what was my machines lab? Oh, there was a rectifier, and there was motor generator sets, and then there were DC supply going all the labs. Still, in 2014, if some new college gets permission, the first thing they do is that they buy a big rectifier, and they buy a motor generator set, and they search the market to get 3-point starter and 4-point starter, which word industry has dumped 70 years back. That is one problem. Second problem is that we have typical mindset of motor generator and motor, one motor, one generator, and one and different setup for different experiment. We started thinking, can I have all in one solution? Can we bring in the industrial practices? At least what industry uses, bring the same instrumentation to the laboratory. As an outcome of that, we could arrive at this set. This set is capable of performing 25 different experiments. First time in a machine's laboratory, the torque is shown to the student. This is the torque, this is the speed at the shaft. It is not indirect measurement. All signals of the all data acquisition is galvanic isolation is provided, so that computer isolation is possible. We have 6 sets in the lab. All 6 sets can be synchronized to each other so as to form a multi-machine power system. I mean, from a different perspective, it is a power system. From another perspective, it is a microgrid, because both synchronous and induction machine are sitting on the same setup. So here it is an interesting set of 3 machines, where DC machine is acting as a dynamometer. We have synchronous machine here, and here we have induction machine. Digital instrumentation is provided, synchronizer is provided to synchronize the sets, torque measurement and sensing facility with the help of load cell. It is a swinging field dynamometer, and students start the experimentation using by calibrating the experiment. And the accuracy, he himself verifies that the accuracy of the set is 0.3%. If 10 grams weight put on the shaft brings out a torque on the shaft, I mean, if you put a 10 gram weight here, student verifies, yes, there is a change in the torque. So he gets somewhere that strikes into his mind that whatever experimentation I am doing has a meaning. Right. We have all industry standard power analyzers here, and this setup we are right making available to the second year students. Another typical problem which we notice with academia is that we think that these are the undergraduate setups, this is for postgraduate laboratory, and this is a research laboratory. I don't understand. I mean, we decided why can we break these boundaries? Why can't a single setup has a larger bandwidth, and serves the undergraduate student as well as the research student, right? That is something what is real life. I mean, CRO is a CRO. How come it is for undergraduate or a research student, right? So facilities, we tried to develop facilities which on one hand cater to the need of undergraduate experimentation, at the same time it provides a strong research foundation, strong research platform for our faculty and the PhD research scholars. This very simple setup we have made, it costed us 5,000 rupees. It is a 3 lump transformer, and there are certain coils put. We named it a multi-purpose transfer model for ITS to IITs. It is a simple 3 core limb, and student can plug and play with the coils. While ITS student can just look at it as a single phase or three phase transformer with multi secondaries. He can do delta star connections, understand step in, step up, step down, or 1:1 transformer. IIT's, even an IIT student can challenge, this setup can challenge even an IIT student to learn the magnetic effect, deeper learning of the electromagnetics, what happens to the no load current and reactive power when the saturation takes place, what are the complex phenomena such as the circulation current phenomena, and Professor Pramanik narrated that problem of Kirchhoff's. Apparently or superficially you feel that Kirchhoff's voltage law is not obeyed due to the non-conservative magnetic field. So those involved complex deep magnetic circuit problems can also be analyzed. This is an old slide, and at that time we wrote under process of patent, but we decided not to patent anything. These are more closer views. The upper core is removable. I can bring in the saturation. We can insert the magnetic material and bring the artificial air gaps of a desired length. We'll show you. I have video about that also. Then this is another four quadrant. Induction motor drive, here induction machine is used as a dynamometer, both absorption as a generating dynamometer. Capable of measuring a starting torque at zero speed. So it is a regenerative type dynamometer. This is what the real life industry, industry engine testing and motor testing, their quality control department might have. In a good places, very high end experimentation platform. This is another interesting dynamometer we had developed. It is got developed from with the help of vendor. It uses claw pole synchronous machine, and it is a high speed dynamometer. So in a laboratory, every machine is used as a dynamometer. My machine set uses DC machine as a dynamometer. The previous set uses the induction machine as a dynamometer, and here it uses synchronous machine as a dynamometer. So giving a understanding how any machine can act as a energy converter, maybe mechanical to electrical or electrical to mechanical, an applied sort of thing. Now this was the second extension to this setup. Now those machines plants which can be viewed as a emulation of generating plants, because a DC drive, if driving a synchronous machine, it emulates the power, it emulates a thermal system, it emulates a powerhouse. DC machine driving an induction machine emulates the wind power. We have both type of induction machines in the laboratories, squirrel cage as well as slip ring. So it emulates a normal IG based wind generation as well as DFIG based wind generation. So that machine lab from one perspective could be a wind farm, could be a microgrid, could be a integration of diversified generation. And to drive that laboratory, presently in the set we have commercial VFDs as well. So student at third year level do the load test on induction motor direct online starting time, as well as do the load test using variable frequency drive. They do the load testing at 40 hertz, 30 hertz. Now this is a generic AC-DC AC power conditioner. You have AC input this side, DC bus this side, AC output this side. This is a three leg converter. IGBTs are used, so here it is a four leg inverter. So and here it is a splitted capacitor DC bus. These are some features of the setup. All signal conditioning is done so as to make it compatible with the present DSPs. All signals are brought at 2.5 volt level. Firing is done from TTL as well as 2.5 volt level. The IGBT driver circuits are used. They are modular, so that tomorrow replacement is possible. And this setup, when we started naming what applications can be performed on this, the list become endless. I mean, same is AC drive, same is synchronous machine drive, DC drive, every component of FACT devices, active filters, grid interface of renewable, and so on and so forth. So this setup, students are enjoying working with this. They are using this as a ready-made box. Before that, they built up their own inverter, makes a hands-on, gain a hands-on experience. But while developing a real-life system, they use this as a commodity and develop their controllers. So this has started this year. I'm sure in short time our students will have noticeable professional outcome from these experimental setups. This is a spinning ball model. It definitely generates interest among a second year student who is told how a rotating magnetic field is created. He physically sees. When I go back, I remember I have mugged up how the induction motor works, right? Whenever a three-phase supply is given to a three-phase distributed winding, it creates a rotating magnetic field, right? But this model gives a perception, better understanding of this field. We are in the process of developing similar model for a single phase induction machine, where all type of single phase induction motions are, it's an open model, and student can just change a switch, it becomes a capacitor start motor, change another switch, it becomes a split phase motor. As we are running short of time, I have certain videos, I will leave it here, you may copy it if you found them interesting. Right. This is a jumping ring model. This is shown to the first year student, all branches. Here is a coil. Can I run this for few minutes? Very interesting.
This is a jumping ring model. This model consists of an exciting coil and a laminated iron core. This is just paper cover to keep this model clean. Using this jumping ring model, we can explain various phenomena. Here I am exciting this jumping ring anaya, this coil with an AC supply. Here we are applying an excitation of 130 volts given to this coil. If I am exciting it with an AC supply, we will get an alternating magnetic field. Here are various rings are available. One is the copper one, aluminium one, and copper and various structure. If I take this aluminium ring, if I drop this aluminium ring into the magnetic field, this ring can jump up to the certain height. The reason behind this is this ring is a closed structure. The moment if I place this ring in the presence of primary magnetic field, there will be an immediate EMF in this ring. And because of this closed structure, the immediate EMF gets converted to an eddy current. The eddy current can produce a counter action to the main magnetic field. That's why the ring is jumping up to a certain height. Here, if I replace this closed ring with an open ring, these two rings are of identical nature, but the cross-section areas are also same. Only the difference here, this is the closed ring, this one is the open ring. If I drop an open ring, which is the closed ring, this open ring cannot jump. Reason behind this, if I measure the potential distance between these two points, the immediate EMF between these two points, we will get some immediate EMF between these two points. But because this structure is open circuit structure, you won't get any eddy currents in it, that's why this ring cannot jump. If I replace this aluminium ring with a copper ring, these two are a copper ring. One is a thinner ring, and the other one is a thicker ring. If I try with the thinner one, see the effect here. It can jump up to certain height. If I replace this thinner ring with a thicker one, this is also a copper one. It can jump up to certain height. The difference between these two, because this one is a thicker structure, effective cross section area of both the rings is almost same. And because of this ring is a this is thicker compared with this ring.
We have another interesting experiment here, the flux diversion, where the the student excite these coils. It is a three limb structure, and normally we expect that the flux lines will be shared in these two limbs and flux will pass like this, but by inserting a short circuited rings here, the flux diversion can be demonstrated. Student gone inserting rings here, one rings after rings, multiple rings, and a stage comes when the flux created by this coil, instead of passing through this limb, passes through this outer limb. He gets the idea of how the flux diversion is taking place. The same model can be used to explain a complex electromagnetic phenomena. Piece of permanent magnet can be sandwiched here, and electrical excitation, AC or DC excitation, can be applied so that what is happening in air gap field of a real life machine can be emulated. When a synchronous machine undergoes the transient, perhaps the armature reaction is affecting the rotor field, and such complex things can at some level or some feel of that can be given by appropriately if we use a hybrid excitation permanent magnet as well as AC excitation or permanent magnet and DC excitation, which is now a new class of electrical machine is evolving as a hybrid excited machines. So student gets some idea about hybrid excitation. So and one can innovate further. I mean, I'm sure one starts thinking and working on this set, newer and newer experiments will keep coming. So these are similar. I will not show these all videos, how different experiments, what experiments students are performing at first year level. The development is on. We are developing a 15 kilowatt microgrid. Our vibrating undergraduate students have stepped in this ambitious project, which I doubt even dared at master's level in the elite institutes. Our 20 students are developing a microgrid. We are developing a load emulator and pico hydro plant. This is the skeleton of the microgrid. Our undergraduate students are developing. It has DC bus, AC bus, and 10 pilot plants. Already the third year students are working on such problems. There are multiple generations and a group PID control applied with a different control setting, and at third year and final year level, students have so far in last 1 year have already published their work in four or five IEEE conferences. And this is a 3 years project, ambitious project. We are sure that our students will make it successful. At a conclusion or at the end, what I will say, what we learn from this experience, change is really continuous thing, and we need to attract the attention of the student. If they are not looking at us, we need to innovate and attract, and the outcome was that today our 5 students are doing their masters and PhDs in the domain areas in IIT Bombay. In last 3 years, our 5 students, so if you go and visit the ground floor, 5 COEP undergraduates are doing their PhDs and masters, right? So we could attract the top layer undergraduate students. Our students are working in power systems, our students are working in the machines, power electronics areas, which are even IIT is supposed to be the dying areas, right? There are lesser PhDs coming out in IITs in this electromagnetics, electrical machines areas. I feel that we as a group are a bit successful there. These efforts have encouraged us to come out to develop newer and newer laboratories. I must thank again Professor S.V. Kulkarni for giving me this platform to share our experiences and giving opportunity to my 25 students to listen to the stalwarts in this field. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Chaudhary. We have time for one or two questions, Max. So if there are no questions, that means only two things. Either you have understood everything or you have understood nothing.
My open invitation is taken any time in the laboratory. I will look at this. Even you can come on weekends and do the experimentation.
Yeah, we'll have more opportunity to discuss in panel.
Yeah.
In the evening, we'll discuss some of these issues.
Right, let's thank Dr. Chaudhary once more.